Well, I've always been a big fan of Pippi Longstocking, and because she was always a big outside the box thinker. You see her here in the middle, laying on her bed with a balloon tied above it, so she could travel over the world, relaxed, laying on her bed, looking at the world from a distance. And I like that idea always very much. And it also gives a bit a romantic idea, always has given me a romantic idea of a balloon flight, just relaxed, floating above the world and looking at the world from a distance. Well, and about 12 years ago, we got a customer that was a balloon company, a hot air balloon. So we modeled that that business. We had balloons with capacity and planned flights, passengers that could buy tickets, reservations that could be made with the tickets, and a lot of re-reservations because it's a bit strange business. A lot of flights that were planned don't take off because it's too much wind or too much rain, especially in the Netherlands, where this company is based. And you have to have a crew that is driving behind the balloon because it's the balloon is going from A to somewhere B, where the wind brings it. And then they have to take the balloon and the passengers back to A. It's a rather useless way of traveling. And the word domain is always a bit strange, and also domain and model are sometimes switched in discussions. So what is a domain? And if you think of math, then you have a function, and the function is taking values from a domain. So the pink one here is the domain. And it's depicting its values on an image. And I like that word image also very much. An image, it makes an image of the domain. And that is also what a model does. And in so you could see the image as a model of that domain. When we are modeling for software, we attach also values to points in the domain. We do that by attaching language to it, attaching words, sentences, meaning to things in the domain, and make an image of that domain. And this is also called the picture theory of language, as was stated by Wittgenstein in 1918. And if you make a picture of something, you also make a kind of two-dimensional model of something. You abstract from a lot of things that are not relevant. So, for instance, with the balloon, we abstracted from the color of the balloon, was not relevant. Here in this architectural model, it's not intended to build white houses or to plant white trees. It's something in the model that is not important. So you, because you abstract, the model is always wrong. Because it's not never one-on-one with the reality, with the domain. But it is about whether it is useful to make a model. And you can also go from the model to the domain, for, as we saw with the architectural model, that you build something where you use the model as an example. If we are modeling for software, we always use language. And when you use language, there's a lot of implicit meaning and a lot of interpretation always. For instance, I said the capacity of a balloon that we had in such in that domain. But that's not only how many people fit in a basket, it's also dependent on the outside temperature. If it's very warm, you can take a person less with you. And if it's very cold, you can take a person more. So it's a bit, you should sell tickets for the number of kilos given the outside temperature. But that sells a bit, it's not so easy to sell that. So they sell tickets for passengers. And then afterwards, they ask the passengers, what's the estimated total weight of all the people you bought the ticket for? If you want to understand a problem, you first have to model if you want to model a solution, you first have to model a problem. You first have to understand the domain. And you do that by modeling the domain, so attaching meaning, attaching language to things in the domain, and you always have a lot of interpretation with that. If you have a if you use a bit different language, then you would get a little bit different understanding of the domain. That's also the core of linguistic relativity, that says when you are using a different language, you get a different view of things. Or said the other way around, if you have a different worldview, you use different language. That was founded in the 19th century, here in Berlin also, by Wilhelm von Humboldt, who started that linguistic relativity. And now still in Berlin, the university is called the Humboldt Universiteit. It's for the one who started that linguistic relativity idea. In 1930s, Edward Sapir and Benjamin Whorf explored different languages. And for instance, Benjamin Whorf investigated or researched Hopi languages, a Native American language. And in that language, you don't have a past and a future. And he found out that that was very consistent with their cosmology of seeing time as a cyclic thing. And so they formulated, not together, but afterwards it was called the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, they formulated that the worldview of people and their language could have some similarities. You can have that very big, you can see it very small, that language can have maybe some effects on thought. There has been a lot of investigations for that, but very interesting, we have no time for that. So many aspects you have in language, it's very nice. But a very recent investigation was by an economist, Keith Chen, from Yale University, who was researching saving behavior. And how much people save is very different from country to country. And he had Chinese parents, and also in Chinese, you don't have a past tense and a future tense. You don't. It's in fact a rather simple language, Chinese. You don't have a conjugation of verbs, you don't have plurals, etc. But he correlated the saving behavior of people with languages having a future tense or not having a future tense. And he found out that people speaking a language having a future tense tend to save 5% less than people not having a future tense. Yeah, strange. And his idea was that people having a future tense in their language tend to put the future further away. So that's why they less care about the future and would save less. Well, it's a lot debatable how he uses those data, etc. And there's been a lot of critique on that Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. For instance, last century by Noam Chomsky, Steven Pinker, etc. But more recent One thing I have to say, that research of Keith Chen is a very nice TED talk about it, only quarter of an hour, so you should look at that. It's very nice to see. But a more recent critique on the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis is from John McWhorter, a linguist. And this little book, The Language Hoax, is very nice to read. It's like seeing a series of episodes of Mythbusters. And if reading a book is a bit too much, it's also on YouTube. A short version, 3/4 hour. You don't have to make pictures of it because all the links are on hermanperen.nl, and then you have all the links of everything I showed, and you can look that. But it's a very nice video. You have to be a bit careful also with that Sapir-Whorf. It has been misused. Like, for instance, if you say how people think is related, how people think is related to their language, then people sometimes say, okay, but this is a very simple language, then it must be very simple people, maybe inferior people. And then it becomes very tricky business. So you have to be very careful using that Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. But what you can say is we use different words for all kinds of things in all kinds of situations. For instance, if you're living in the Arctic region, it might be handy to have some few words more for snow. Or if you're living in the Netherlands, for instance, it's handy that we have more than 30 words for rain. Yeah. You know, pijpenstelen, buitje, motregen, bak uit de hemel. Nog even af. Don't mention the pleuris weer, pokken weer, etc. But okay, we have more than 30 words for it. But if you're living in the Sahara, you don't need all those words. So another environment gives you the need almost to have different words to understand that environment. And that's also what is happening when you are looking at a certain domain. In a domain, you always have specific language. And that's why when modeling, we should look at the language of the domain, because that gives us a good idea of what the domain is. They have special language. And don't use your technical language as a template put over the domain and try to put the domain into your technical idea that you already have. I was once at a modeling session where they were working with that client already for a long time, and they were talking with the client about tables and foreign keys, etc. And I said, okay, when we are modeling, we don't say anything technical. And they said, yeah, but we already worked with that client for years. He understands it. I said, yeah, but it's not about that you that the client understands you and your technical stuff. It's about that you understand the client and his domain or her domain. We had that also with the balloons. They were talking about morning flights, evening flights, and I thought, why no lunch flights then? But that appeared that it was something from the domain, because during the day you can't fly safely a balloon because you have too much thermic hot air going up and cold air going down. So listening to the things in the domain gives you an idea. So we modeled the whole domain. We made a class diagram. Client was very impressed, but thought, yeah, but now the software. But okay, you see it's much too complicated. It has been split in several models later, but this was really implemented in ORM Designer and made in PHP. And okay, trying to understand, but what you see already is when you are modeling, sometimes you add some complexity that is not even in the domain. The domain is complex enough. So try to focus on the complexity of the domain and not add extra complexity. Trying to understand the world around you or a domain is not new, is what has been happening by philosophers a long time already. Only the philosophers don't talk about one domain, but talk about the world or the universe. Like Wittgenstein in his Tractatus, what I mentioned is the picture theory of language. He defined his domain as the world and defined that as the world is everything that is the case. If we go way back, why not? We can learn something from old philosophers. Aristotle tried to categorize all the different kinds of being, because one kind of being is not the same as another kind of being. And those different categories he gave, I just look at one of them, and that is he made a difference between things that can exist on their own and things that can only be attributes or properties of something. That's a different kind of being. For instance, if you have a red balloon, then the balloon can exist on its own, but the redness of the balloon cannot exist without something that is red. So it's a different kind of being. And you also cannot say you don't have really two different entities, the balloon and its redness. And the same when you have an invoice and invoice lines, you don't say to someone, I'll send you the invoice and the invoice lines too. That those are not two different things, that they belong together. So in 17 centuries later, William of Ockham also said, just cut down all the extra entities that you don't need. choose for the simplest solution. That's not always true. I've got a nice example is this guy with the nice hair. It's Sir Isaac Newton. Oh, just a microphone. Okay. Sir Isaac Newton, and he modeled time and space as extra entities, and he could do some calculations with it. So he added those things to his model because it was useful. And it makes his models more useful. Well, he had a lot of quarrel about that with this worker there. It's Leibniz, who wrote about monads, but not the monads from category theory, and who invented differential calculus. He had a lot of quarrels with Newton. He was quarreling about everything with Newton, but also about this, that he said that time and space are not things that exist outside of the things that are. If you put away all the things, you don't have anything like time and space. And Newton said, no, you have absolute time and space. More Platonic idea about time and space. And this discussion was settled two generations later by Kant, who said, no, you're both wrong. It's not that time is something outside the things. It's not something emerging from the things or being inside the things. It's something in the observer. It's an idea that we already a priori have in our head. It's how we look at the things. You cannot observe time, he said also. You cannot empirically see it. So for instance, if I have this card here and I drop it, you didn't see a drop. You didn't see it fall. Yeah, really. What you saw is that I had it here in my hand. What you saw is that it was here. What you saw is that it laid on the floor. You only see one thing at one moment. The rest is interpretation, because you had something in your memory that you saw. And you compared what you see with what you had in your memory, and you put some order in it that you said that you concluded that one thing had happened earlier. So you didn't see it fall. It's interpretation already. One of the best books I have ever read, and there is a free PDF on the internet. Yeah. Legally, totally, it's already from 1949. It's Gilbert Ryle, The Concept of Mind. It's a big rant against the Cartesian dualism. You know, Descartes saw body and mind as two totally different things. And he went against that and said that myth of the ghost in the machine, as he called it, as Rao called it, is a logical error. It is a category mistake. And in the book, he gives a lot of examples of what is a category mistake. I'll give you two examples Rao gives. He said, if you're going to Oxford, for instance, and you're shown there the colleges, the playing field, scientific departments, administrative offices, etc., and you have seen that all, and then you ask, yeah, but where is the university? Or if you're showing a game of cricket for the first time, and someone shows you all the roles of all the players, you have bowlers and batsmen and fielders and umpires and scorers, and when you have seen that, you say, okay, but where is the player that is responsible for the famous team spirit? That is all a category mistake. Why is that? Because when you're looking at all those buildings, buildings are a different category than the institution of a university. And also, team spirit is of a different category than the different roles of all the players. So you're comparing different categories with each other, and that's a category mistake. You have that, for instance, if you say, I have the invoice and the invoice lines, that those are two things of a different category. You can't put them conjunctively or disjunctively in one sentence together without making a category mistake. Conjunctively is with and disjunctively is with or. But if we are modeling, often in domain-driven design, for instance, sometimes we make a class diagram, like I showed in earlier. And a class diagram, everything is a class. Or if you are modeling as in a relational database, everything is a table. So you can have a table for invoices and a table for invoice lines. You don't see the different categories anymore. You abstract it from those categories, and thereby you introduce, by using that technical language, a category mistake. And that is done more often. But for instance, if you have a country, I have a tiny country where I come from here, that country is defined by its borders. That country has borders, but you can't say, here I have the country and I have the borders. That, at the same time, as two different entities. If that would be so, then the borders would be of the same category as a country. That would be something with borders. And those borders would have borders, and those borders would have borders, etc. So it's a logical mistake to take that as an extra entity. But in domain-driven design, we define the boundaries of a model as a bounded context. you can read about it and hear about it in talks, that a bounded context, you can treat that as the borders of a country. And then they're going to talk about what are the boundaries of that bounded context. You know, that's a kind of the same category mistake. You are looking at the borders of the borders of the borders of a country. And I think that could be simpler. And by taking Occam's razor, you say, okay, a model is constrained by the consistency of language. A bounded context is constrained by the consistency of language. So, in fact, they are the same. It's one thing. It's not two different things. Like a country and its borders are not two different things. It's otherwise you would make a category mistake. Don't misunderstand me. Sometimes people think that I am saying that bounded context is not a good concept. No. It's a very important concept. There are two main things in domain-driven design to use, and that is use the language of the domain, as we saw before, and split your model in different models, in different bounded contexts. The only thing I'm saying is that that's essential to do that, to split it in different contexts, in different models, bounded context, whatever you want to call it, images. It's all the same, I think. I lost track a bit. So, split it in different models and do that, but I only want to say it's simpler than some people would think. If you're looking at domain-driven design, it's not a lot of difficult words. It's just you have models, and sometimes they call that bounded context. Sometimes you could call it something else. It's not very important. It's a model is bounded by the consistency of the language. What do we mean with language? Do we mean a different programming language? No. Because when we say programming language, there's a very nice article of Alvaro Videla last year who wrote about an article was a programming language is not a language. How can it then? That why do we call it a language? It has syntax and it has semantics. Yes, but he said it is a metaphor. And a metaphor is only valid to a certain extent. So you can't say it is the same as a language, but it is like a language. It has similarities. And as Umberto Eco says, a programming language is always parasitic. What he means by it is that the meaning of the things you use in your model are not in the programming language. So you can make an entity of a planned flight, of a balloon, of whatever you want, but the meaning of those things is in the natural language, not in the program. You can't look up in your C-sharp manual, not even in Kotlin, what a planned flight is. I want to emphasize that you have that modeling is a different stage in making software than the implementation. If you're modeling, you're always using the meaning it has in a natural language. So that's why a model is bounded by the meaning of it in the natural language. And then you can make it you can implement that in some programming language. Yesterday in a presentation, this was called the technical domain, and that was called the domain, but I don't agree completely with that, because then you're switching the word domain and model in a way. So this would be the technical model, and that would be the model, the real model. Maybe you could ask from is a different natural language than giving you a different model? Well, not completely, because for instance, if you have developers that only talk English and you want to have a model in the native language where you are working, then maybe you can have two models, but still the meaning of it is in the natural language has to be the same. And you can have a whole discussion. This is a bit debatable. Yeah, but if I have a totally different paradigm, for instance, if I'm more temporal modeling instead of more structural, would that give you another model? Well, we did that with reservations that were first modeled classical in a one-to-many relationship, later we had events sourced that stuff. So flight was planned, reservation was made, flight was cancelled, flight took off. Also happens. Then after we did that, I asked myself, but do I have to go now to the client to say, oh, we have a totally different model now? Oh, how come? We now make reservations, and yeah, we already had that. And so for the client, nothing changed in this. Maybe with some complex things, some things would change, but for us, nothing changed. A difference of how some people in domain-driven design see abandoned context and I see it is that I said both are bounded by the natural language that you use, by the meaning of things in the natural language. And so for me, abandoned context is the same as a model. And for some people for a lot of people in domain-driven design, they say, yeah, but abandoned context includes also the implementation. Okay, it's just a matter of definition. I think it's bounded by the meaning it has in a natural language. So that's why I limit it only to the model. I say, it's a nice word, although you don't have an unbounded context, so it's a bit strange word, but it has been used for 16 years, so keep using it, why not? It's also you share the language within one model with your customers, so that's called the ubiquitous language. It's also a bit strange word because it is not ubiquitous, it's only limited to the model. But okay, I call it the model language. Sometimes things can be a bit simpler, thanks to Mr. Ockham. But you try to express in a language a model, and a language is sometimes difficult. It takes you everywhere, and it's hard to exactly define what you want to say. And it also has limits. Like Wittgenstein, in the same Tractatus, said, that was the last sentence of the Tractatus, that you can't, beyond the limits of language, you can't say things anymore, not in a philosophical, scientific way, at least. And if you want to go beyond the limits of language, you have to use art. But that is a bit difficult to make software with that. Maybe we should have painting workshops with the customers, but yeah, to make software from that, to go beyond the limits of language. And it is not necessary, because I think there is an escape from this prison that language is. Language has its limits, but you can escape from it. And that escape was given in 1931 by Kurt Gödel, who wrote his incompleteness theorems. And the incompleteness theorems come down to this simple thing, that if you have a game of a certain complexity, you can always add new rules to the game that are not deductible, that are not cannot be derived from the existing rules. Now, language is such a game, is such a set of rules. It has you can count in it, you can have basic arithmetic, so it complies to the requirements of the incompleteness theorem. That means language can always be expanded. You can always make new language that cannot be derived from the existing language. So you can have new thoughts that cannot be derived from the existing thoughts. That really means creativity is infinite. And I think that is a great thing. So you can expand the language, and that is also what happened already within a domain. Within any domain, you already expand language. Some specific jargon is always already an expansion of the language. And you can be creative with that to find new words, like we also did with the ballooning. We had some words for things that existed in the domain, but we didn't have real words for it, so we invented new words for that. And you can also take the freedom, like Newton did, to model things, to find new words for it even, for new words for things that are not in the domain, but make the domain more understandable. Okay, to wrap this whole thing up. If you are looking at the domain, then every domain has its special words and even has expanded language, as we see here, for especially that domain. So if you want to understand the domain, use the language of the domain. Be careful when you try to understand the domain not to do that too much with a technical language. And that's even universal modeling language, UML, class diagrams, or BPML, or those are technical languages. So you should be careful with that. If you are modeling in a technical language, you might lose something of the meaning, like categories, from the natural language. So avoid that. You should divide your model in different models, submodels, different bounded contexts, or however you want to call them. And do that with consistency of meaning. I once saw a tweet of someone saying, yeah, it's consistency of language, so it should also take the syntax, to look at the syntax differences. But I think it is not. It should only look at the difference of meaning. What do you mean by the words you use? It's a very nice idea that to know that model language is expandable. You can always find new words. You don't have to model that one-to-one with the things in the domain. And I think a point of me is maybe to better document the model also, because when you are splitting in a model and implementation, then you are communicating with your customer about the model. Oh, shit. What's this? You should, if you're communicating with a customer, you're communicating about that model and not about the implementation only. I'm almost finished. Come on. Sometimes it's doing... Oh, no. Then I have to go through everything. Okay, but... the... So it was, yeah.
I'm a wrap up like this.
Yeah, that I always liked that when in school, when I was young, we had slides, really slides. They slided, and then in the end, they were on a roll of film, and they could go to the next one, and then in the end, they were always turned back, so you got a view back. So we're doing that, but then okay, you have a whole summary of everything I said. When we are modeling, it's again here. When we are modeling, so that's good, this one is here. We are using natural language. We are communicating about that with the client. And the implementation is more the technical stuff, the technical domain. And when you are communicating with your customer, you can't say, you should maybe document that model a bit. And some people say, yeah, but we write very nice code. We have all the documentation in the code. Yeah, but how many of your customers read your code? That's a bit tricky. And there's also a book from Cyril Martraire called Living Documentation. And yesterday there was also a presentation about using tests as documentation, and it looked very nice because they also showed the whole sequence of things you have to do somewhere. So a whole process was also shown in different tests in a row. So there are means to document models in a natural language with which you can communicate about it with the customer. Okay, quit Gödel and expanding the language and the summary of the summary. Yeah, maybe. The summary of the summary. But this was what I had to say about the domain of the balloons. Only want to add that maybe we sometimes should listen a bit more to strong Swedish girls that with pigtails that have to say something. And for instance, with a balloon, it's very fun, but you use a lot of fuel just for fun. And I like sitting around a fire with some people, but it's not the most efficient way to use your fuel, to use wood. And so there are a lot of things that, and I think that's a bit of a dilemma also, because it gives something extra to life. And I want to enjoy the life, but I also want to be a bit careful for the planet. By the way, writing balloon with three L's, how dare you? But and also, especially as developers, I think we have some responsibility to look what we are doing. We are working for other companies, and do we agree with their policy? We are part of that, and we should take that responsibility, I think. So, thank you very much. And I've even got some time for a few questions or... Yeah, this is very important also. What you do then is that you, together with the client, try to understand something in the domain, and you make something new, a new kind of language in your model to understand the domain better. But you always have to couple that back, That is what I had in an earlier slide, that the model is then something as an example that is used to change the domain. And that is also when you make software, sometimes, I think very often, it is inevitable that you also have to change some things in the domain, that you even have to reorganize some things because you are making whole new things, and then sometimes you have to rearrange the whole organization to still be compliant with Conway's law also. So it is important that so you can change things in your model, but you have to do that together with the client, together with the management, and you have to have commitment of everything in the company, everybody in the company, to do that. So I think you can expand your language, but it has a lot of consequences. Someone else, maybe? Not? Well, I'll be around still, and you can talk about, for instance, all the aspects of languages in that Sapir-Whorf hypothesis. There's a lot to tell about that, but that's a whole other talk. Thank you very much. And